Right, a very good evening to all of you. So welcome to another video. I have made this video after a very long time, I know that, and we'll discuss about that a little later or maybe in some other video, right? In today's video, let's focus on the expected topics for the CSIR NET November 2020 examination. So I've been making these predictions from a long time now, and thankfully by God's grace those predictions have come true in most of the cases, and those have been helpful to you. So I feel that this time also it will be helpful and my intuition might be right. Though the last examination that happened was a very long time back, so obviously there could be some unexpected questions also, and I know for a fact there are so many questions in your mind as to what will happen to the December 2020 examination, whether that will happen or not. So what I would recommend right now is not to worry about these things. You just focus on your revision. Once the examination is over, we can discuss about those things, right? I have some information about that, but I don't want to unnecessarily discuss that right now. I want you to focus on the examination, right? So let's talk about the expected topics first, and after that we will go on to the quick revision series where I will basically tell you about the topics. Like, these are the topics, and you just, you can have a pen in your hand and just see that whether you have done those topics or not, right? So first let's talk about the expected topics, or the topics which are, they're not the expected topics so to say, but they are the topics which are basically overlooked by the aspirants, which you should do, which are expected in the examination, right? So those are the topics that I'm talking about. So Beer-Lambert's law, please do that. Please do the equation and solve a few numericals on the Beer-Lambert's law. That is important according to me. Then we have metathesis. Okay, so I have a high expectation that the metathesis reaction, either basically the ring closing metathesis in presence of the Grubbs catalyst, that is a very important question, and I feel that that will come in the organic chemistry portion or the inorganic chemistry. Then we have in 13C NMR spectroscopy, please do DEPT. DEPT has not been asked for a long time, and I expect DEPT to be asked anytime soon, either this examination or the next examination, it is going to come, right? So please do the DEPT, 45, 90, 135, just go through it. It's a very, so these topics which I'm talking about, they are very small topics, like it will take you hardly 1 hour or 30 minutes to do these topics. So just go through them. I'm telling you this so that you don't miss out on them. Okay, then for analytical chemistry, go for chromatography. Okay, do chromatography properly. Ion exchange resins, both cation and anion exchange resins. What is the elution mechanism? How does it basically lead to separation? Okay, because generally I've seen this question is trending that 4 or 5 different reactants are given, and they are maybe passed through an anion exchange resin or a cation exchange resin, and then they ask you which one will elute first and which one will elute later, or they will ask you the trend of the elution. All right. Then phosphorescence and fluorescence. This concept, basically the Jablonski diagram, you have to do well if you have missed it out. Okay, and polarography. So these are some topics from analytical chemistry which I feel students tend to miss out but are important. Polarography, again, it was asked last, I think in 2013 or 14. So again, these questions suddenly come up in the examination, and because of this long gap, I feel, there is a possibility of these questions coming in the examination. Then one topic from organic chemistry, one name reaction I would say from organic chemistry, which everyone tends to overlook, but every other examination it comes, is Birch reduction. So please do not overlook Birch reduction. Try to practice as many examples as possible from the Birch reduction portion. Then stereoisomerism in coordination compounds. So when we talk about coordination chemistry, it's a vast topic, I know that, but somehow students tend to miss out stereoisomerism. So just in case if you have missed out stereoisomerism, do it because it is important. Alright. Then we have from organic chemistry again, do all olefinations. Okay, whichever name reaction book you basically you get your hands on, be it G-Jack Lee, C-Zacco, or from Clayton also, if you go at their back, just look out for olefinations. Okay, just search all the olefination reactions that are given in these name reaction books and do all the olefinations, because olefination every time comes, and sometimes they definitely put up a different kind of olefination reaction. There are some common ones like Peterson olefination, Julia Konsinski olefination, then other Wittig reactions. So these are the common ones, but apart from that also you will see like Tebbe olefination. Okay, so all kinds of olefination name reactions that you know of, you do all those. Okay, similarly you do all the rearrangement kind of reactions also. Okay, whatever rearrangement reactions that you can come across, do all of them. And pericycle, of course. Okay, in pericycle basically focus upon like you, I know you will not miss out pericyclic, but in pericyclic there's one important sigmatropic reaction which is I have seen is fairly common, which is 2-3 sigmatropic rearrangement. So if you are planning to, you know, not study sigmatropic reactions because some of you find it difficult, just go through the examples of 2-3 sigmatropic reaction. Okay. One more thing that I forgot, actually I wanted to state this at the starting of the video. I am coming up with a revision series, okay? So on Unacademy and on YouTube, both I'll be making revision series, okay? So on Unacademy, it's free of cost, right? So you don't have to pay, you just have to download the app. And I think if you can download the Hotstar app to watch IPL matches, surely you can download the Unacademy app and watch some lectures over there, right? So I'll be going through the revision series. So whatever topics I'm mentioning over here, for most of those topics, I will be making revision videos both over here on YouTube and also on Unacademy. And secondly, I have made a lot of crash courses on some of these topics. So I'll give you the link to all the crash courses that I've made down in the description box. Okay. Then we have Hammond's postulate. You do this. Then for a long time, I have been predicting green chemistry question. Okay. It has not been asked, but recently it has been incorporated in the GATE syllabus. So again, I feel that this green chemistry is important, especially, you know, questions like E factor, how to calculate E factor. It is a very easy question, but you need to know the formula of how to calculate the E factor or the atom economy of a reaction. So just go through the principles of green chemistry. It will hardly take you 20-25 minutes. I mean, especially the atom economy and the E factor, how to calculate it. Then we have in mass spectrometry, the isotopic effect. That please do this concept. That if you're leaving out mass spectrometry, at least do McLaughlin rearrangement. And second, please do the isotopic effect. That what happens to the ratio, or what are the ratio of peaks when there are two isotopes present. Alright. Then from molecular spectroscopy, from everyone does the equations really well. All the kind of numericals, whatever numericals are there, everyone practices them well. But somehow, sometimes you tend to miss out the questions on oblate, prolate. Okay, what kind of molecule it is, whether it is oblate or whether it is prolate. So just go through that concept once. Okay. Then inorganic, again, this is a topic from inorganic spectroscopy. Try to do as many examples as you can from inorganic spectroscopy, particularly the fluxional molecules. Okay, there are 10 or 15 examples. Few of the examples are given in BD Gupta, okay, in organometallics of fluxional molecules. And I think other examples you can find in Crabtree. So you can do the examples from these two books. Okay, one more thing in Claydon, in the protecting, deprotecting chapter, okay, protecting groups and deprotecting groups. In the end of the chapter, you will see that they have given a summary of all the protecting and deprotecting groups, like in what conditions the protecting groups can be deprotected. Okay, so there are certain conditions in which certain protecting groups can be deprotected. Just go through that summary that is given in the end of the chapter. It's a very, very important summary that is given in Claydon. All right. Next, one thing that is hardly take you 10 minutes, but it can fetch you at least 2 marks in the examination is, you do the formula for standard deviation, you do the formula for variation, and you do the formula for calculating standard error. So how to calculate error, how to calculate standard deviation, and how to calculate variation. These three things at least you should do. Okay. And apart from that, I think these are the expected, topics, in the sense the ones that we tend to overlook, but they are important. Now coming to, the topics from inorganic, physical, and organic separately. I'm not going to discuss each and every topic, but I'm just going to give you a gist of the important topics, right? So from organometallics, we have 18 electron rule. Okay, let's talk about inorganic chemistry first. So 18 electron rule, the reaction mechanism. Okay, the reaction mechanism involves association reaction, dissociation reaction, oxidative addition, migratory insertion, beta hydride elimination, okay, reductive elimination. These topics. Then we come to metal carbonyls, and metal carbonyls especially pay attention to the IR frequencies of how it varies. Again, I have made videos on these topics. Then for cluster, okay, it's a vast topic. It will definitely be coming in the examination. But for clusters, I have made an excellent video. Okay, I am stating it myself, but it is actually a worth watching video. So what I would tell you is, or I'll give you the link somewhere over here or somewhere over here, I guess. So just watch that video, okay? It's a 1-hour video, but that will clear out all your concepts on clusters. And then at the end, organometallic catalysis, right? The Monsanto acetic acid process and whatever catalytic cycles are there, Wilkinson's catalyst is there. So whatever catalysts are there in organometallics, in the end, in the BD Gupta also, there's a chapter on catalysis. So just do that, okay? Then coming on to coordination. In coordination, the first thing that you need to keep in mind is electronic spectra. Okay, in electronic spectra, we can talk about MLCT, LMCT transitions. Then we can talk about the color of coordination compounds. Okay, then Auriger diagram. So these are some of the important topics from coordination. Then crystal phase stabilization energy, d orbital splitting of various geometries. Okay, what is the d orbital splitting? Then the Jahn-Teller distortion, right? Then isomerism, like I had previously stated, isomerism of coordination compounds. Then reaction mechanism, of course, inner sphere mechanism, outer sphere mechanism, SN1, basically your nucleophilic conjugate based mechanism, SN1CB, and basically all the the charts, like the tables, basically like the trans effect table, the water exchange rate table. Okay, then there is nephloxetic effect table. So all these tables you should have on your tips. Okay, again, when I'll be doing the revision videos, there also I'll be discussing all this. But in case you have already prepared or you want to prepare by yourself, then these are some of the topics that you need to keep in mind. Again, I'm stating this is not an exhaustive list. I mean, there might be some other topics. I'm just giving you a broader overview of the topics. Then lanthanides and actinides, of course. And in lanthanides and actinides, you need to pay special focus to the electronic configuration of the lanthanides and actinides. Because if you know the electronic configuration, it becomes much more easier to solve questions from lanthanides and actinides. And obviously, you need to pay some attention to their oxidation states. Like, what is the trend of the oxidation states in lanthanides and actinides? Then obviously in organic spectroscopy, like I told you, it's a very important aspect. It is definitely going to be tested. And at last, you can consider this topic in physical chemistry or in organic chemistry, it's your wish. That is group theory. So in group theory, you need to be able to predict the symmetry or a point group of a particular element. And the second thing that is important is the missing characters. How to find out the missing characters in a character table? For that, you can use the grand orthogonality theorem. Okay. And apart from that, there are some other questions as well. Again, I'll give you the link to the group theory video somewhere over here or somewhere over here, wherever it might come. Right. So these are some of the important topics from inorganic chemistry. Now coming on to organic. In organic chemistry, there are three or four important topics which are definitely going to be asked, and for the rest of the topics, if you prepare well, you will be able to answer, right? So for stereochemistry, do the RNS nomenclature for all systems, which involves alenes, biphenyls, cyclophanes, helical chirality, then spirenes, okay, and then norborane systems. So do the RNS nomenclature. Then One thing where students struggle is RNS nomenclature of epoxides. So make sure you do the RNS nomenclature of epoxides. I'm telling you, if it comes in the examination, you won't be able to answer. You'll get confused. So just go through the RNS nomenclature of epoxides. Again, I've made a video on this. You'll find the link down in the description box for all these videos that I'm stating, or you'll find it somewhere over here. Depending if I have the time to edit, I'll do that. Then we have enantiomeric excess and topicity. Okay. So enantiotopic, diastereotopic, how to find that out, and then enantiomeric excess, how to find enantiomeric excess. There are various numericals that have come in the examination. Apart from that, there might be a question asking you the number of stereoisomers in an asymmetric molecule or a symmetric molecule. So there are three formulas, two for symmetric molecules, depending on the number of chiral centers. If the number of chiral centers are even, there is one formula. If the number of chiral centers are odd, there is one formula. And then there is one formula for asymmetric asymmetric molecules. So this formula is for the symmetric molecules, where we can find the number of stereoisomers, a number of optical isomers, a number of meso compounds. So that we can find out using these formulas. And now coming to pericyclic and photochemistry. So in pericyclic, all of you know, you need to concentrate on electrocyclic and Diels-Alder. Okay, now I am coming to sigmatropic. I told you that if you have the time, you do 3-3 sigmatropic reactions, and along with that, like do 2-3 sigmatropic rearrangement. Okay, coming to photochemistry, if you have not prepared photochemistry at all, what I would recommend you is do 3 named reactions in photochemistry. One is Norrish type 1, the another is Norrish type 2, and the third one is your Paternò-Bucci reaction. Okay, so these three reactions you should do from photochemistry at least, so that if a direct question comes, you are able to answer. Okay, next is organic spectroscopy, I told you, do the 13C NMR properly. That is the DEPT NMR. Okay, and mass, I told you, McLaughlin and isotopic effect. IR, you should know for carbonyl molecules. The ones which are having a carbonyl functionality, you should know the IR stretching frequencies like ketone, aldehyde, carboxylic acid, amide, anhydride. For all these, you should know the stretching frequencies. And apart from that, for UV spectroscopy has not been asked much in the examination. It has been asked. So for that, you should know in what conditions bathochromic shift happens and in what conditions hypsochromic shift happens. Like what effect does solvent have on the highest occupied molecular orbital and the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. So for UV spectroscopy, you should know in what conditions bathochromic shift happens and in what conditions hypsochromic shift happens. Okay. So then we have reactive intermediates. In reactive intermediates, the questions can be unlimited. Okay, there are so many examples of reactive intermediate based questions because carbenes are a very popular intermediate and it is a very important, it is a very popular reaction involving carbenes, right? So there can be unlimited amount of questions that can be generated from this. But the thing that you need to focus on is that there are very limited amount of ways by which you can generate a carbene. So if you are able to identify a carbene is generated, then if you have practiced enough questions on carbenes, you can easily find out what the product might be. Okay, it's very, very easy to find out the product once you know that a carbene is generated. So rather than focusing on the reactions, I would recommend you focus on how a carbene is generated, what are the different methods, so that in the examination, at least you are able to identify that a carbene is being generated. Okay. In heterocyclics, the only thing that you need to worry about is, see, the reagent will do its part. But the thing that you need to worry about is you need to know the electrophilic and nucleophilic centers in various heterocyclic molecules like indole, furan, pyran, pyrrole. So for these kind of molecules, you should know the nucleophilic and electrophilic centers. If you know this basic aspect, thiophene, furan, pyrrole, indole, pyridine, quinolines, if you know the nucleophilic and electrophilic centers for this molecule, you're good to go. If you know what the reagent is going to do, you will be easily able to predict it. Okay, the questions, if you see the previous year questions, all of them are dependent upon the core itself, that what kind of heterocyclic molecule is given to you. So if you can predict, and especially if you see in the last 4 to 5 years, all the questions have been based on pyridine. So at least be sure of the electrophilic and nucleophilic centers in pyridine. That if we are adding a nucleophile, where is it more likely to undergo attack on which position of pyridine? Okay, so you should be aware of this. Okay. Anything else? Yeah. For natural products, some of you ask me what to do in natural products. So in natural products, just read a bit about terpenes. I think that is good enough. Apart from that, I mean, it's a very vast topic. And if you can just go through terpenes, if you're lucky enough, the question might come on terpenes. Otherwise, I don't think it is valuable to give time to natural products now. Okay. And then same goes for amino acids and carbohydrates. So like I said, for carbohydrates and amino acids, you can avoid it because the topic is really vast. And the kind of questions that come are very diverse, right? So it's better to like leave out the topic. If you've done it, it's good. But if you are trying to revise it, I would say there are many more valuable topics to revise as of now. So you can avoid carbohydrates and amino acids, right? In inorganic chemistry, I missed out one topic, that is bio-inorganic chemistry, which is also important. And personally speaking, I don't recommend revising main group chemistry. Again, the same reason, because the topic is vast and the weightage, even if the weightage is good enough, but I mean the topic is too big to actually predict the kind of questions that might be asked. And for reactive intermediates in organic chemistry, carbenes and nitrines is one important topic that I mentioned. Apart from that, benzene is also an important topic. Okay. Coming to physical chemistry, physical chemistry I believe is one of the easiest topics to do and to predict the kind of questions that might come from it. Okay, so in physical chemistry, the important topics, all of them have very good weightage, but the ones that students tend to overlook, which is easy comparatively, is statistical thermodynamics. In statistical thermodynamics, please do the Boltzmann formula. Through the Boltzmann formula, you can calculate questions which are based upon, the fraction of molecules in a particular energy state. These are very common questions and I feel they will keep coming. These are important questions, right? So Boltzmann distribution. And the second one is your, One is Boltzmann distribution, partition function. Okay, then there are questions from partition function which are very direct. Okay, they are very direct formula based questions. So just do the questions on partition function, right? There are three formulas for partition function. Just go through those formulas. And then we have quantum. Obviously in quantum, see, many students get afraid of quantum. Quantum is the kind of questions I would say are asked in the examination. They are very straightforward, very easy. You don't need any tutor for that as such. Okay, I mean, the questions are either from commutator, or it could be from particle in 1D box, particle in 3D box, harmonic oscillator. Then there are questions based on the a particular wave function is given for a hydrogen atom and you need to predict which orbital it is. Then there are questions from perturbation theory, variation theorem. There are questions from degeneracy. There are questions from Huckel molecular orbital theory. So these are some of the questions that you can see in quantum, and if you do this, it's good enough. I mean, you don't need to do the complex questions, or if five questions come, you can skip one question, it will not make a difference. So just focus on these basic questions first, and then if you are confident enough, you can go for the advanced ones. In molecular spectroscopy, like I said, focus on prolate and oblate. Apart from that, focus on the mutual exclusion principle. Okay, you should know what the mutual exclusion principle states, and that's about it. Then if you want me to go in detail in molecular spectroscopy, then in rotational and vibrational spectra, you should know the selection rules. Again, students tend to overlook this aspect, that what is the selection rule. It might look very very easy, but it kind of you get confused if it comes with the examination. So go through the selection rules and what are the criteria for a molecule to be rotational active, for a molecule to be vibrational active, for a molecule to be Raman active. What are the kind of vibrations which are Raman active? What are the kind of vibrations which are IR active? You should know these theories. Okay, again, I made video on this. You can find the link in the description or somewhere over here. Okay. Then in rotational spectroscopy, specifically, you should concentrate on questions involving where hydrogen is replaced by deuterium. Okay, like for example, they will ask you what is the bond length of DCl, like what is the bond length of a particular molecule where a hydrogen has been replaced by deuterium, or what will happen to the stretching frequency of a molecule if the hydrogen is replaced by deuterium. Okay, so there are direct formulas. Like if you are going for vibrational frequency and if you are replacing the hydrogen by deuterium, then you have to divide it by 2. But in rotational spectroscopy, if you are trying to find out, let's say a particular parameter, okay, then over there you have to divide it by root 2. I mean, if you are aware of this concept, you would be able to relate to what I am saying. Then there's solid state. In solid state, there are two numerical based questions that are very common. One is based on the density, that is D equal to Zm by A cube Na, and the second one is your Bragg's law, okay, and N lambda equal to 2d sin theta. Then kinetics, I've already discussed. I made many strategy videos. I'll give you one link to one of the strategy videos over here. In kinetics, you know what things to focus on: zero order, first order, second order, T half. Then your Arrhenius equation, your enzyme catalysis, particularly Michaelis-Menten equation, and Lineweaver-Burk plot. Okay, actually there are two plots. One is Lineweaver-Burk plot. I am not remembering which is the second plot. In Puri Sharma and Pathania, in the enzyme catalysis chapter, okay, there is a book called Puri Sharma and Pathania. In the enzyme catalysis chapter, there are two plots. One is the Lineweaver-Burk plot, and then there is another plot. I am forgetting the name. Those two plots are very important from exam perspective. Okay, then electrochemistry is there. If you haven't revised electrochemistry and if you want to do it now, what I would suggest is just know how to calculate the E naught value and the Nernst equation. That is good enough. If you are doing it right now, if you have been doing it for a long time, or if you have done it previously and you want to revise, then you can go through other topics. But if you are someone who is just beginning with electrochemistry, or who wants to just go, just do the simple formulas, then just go through E naught and Nernst equation. Similarly, in thermodynamics, I feel there are many topics, but I feel Carnot cycle is very important for this upcoming examination. Then there are some miscellaneous topics like surface chemistry. In surface chemistry, just do the formula for surface tension, and you should know what exactly is chemiosorption, what are the parameters, or what are the physical properties, what are the properties of chemiosorption, what are the properties of physiosorption, how are chemiosorption and physiosorption different. Then you can do BET isotherm, Langevin adsorption isotherm. So from surface chemistry, this is good enough. Then there are other topics like colloids and polymers and chemical bonding, that is from inorganic. So these topics, I mean, for polymer I have made a crash course, again you will find the link in the description box. Colloids, if you want to do, you can, that's up to you. If I was preparing for this examination, I would avoid colloids, okay? I think these are some of the topics that are important and relevant from the exam perspective. So anyway, I hope this video was helpful. In case you feel I have missed out very important topics, you can let me know down in the comment section, and it will be helpful to the aspirants also. So I would recommend all of you just to go through the comment section of the video, so that just in case I have missed out any important topic and somebody points that out, I'll pin it up and you can find it in the top comments, so that you don't miss out that particular topic. Alright, so anyway, all the very best, and stay subscribed to this channel, stay updated to this channel, because now you will see a flurry of revision videos on this channel till the November 2020 exam. It's not the June 2020 examination anymore. And I wish you all the best. If you like this video, please do share it. I need your support, because that is the only thing that actually keeps me going and making these videos, right? So thank you so much, and wish you all the best. Hey guys, so I'm a verified educator on Unacademy, and along with that I'm also available on the Unacademy Plus platform, where I'm taking live classes along with other educators. So in case you're interested in attending the live classes, you can subscribe to the Unacademy Plus platform using my referral code, that is SETHI SETI, and that will give you 10% discount. Alright, and in case you're not interested in attending the live classes, you can watch the free courses that are available on the Unacademy. For that, all you need to do is go to the Unacademy website or download the Unacademy Learning app and search my name over there, that is ACT. Once you do that, you will get the access to all the free courses that are available on the Unacademy platform.